Broads Media.
Hey, what's going on, everyone? So much drama today. Before we head into it, if you are buying tickets, whether it's baseball playoffs, NBA's coming around the corner, NHL, the Flyers start tonight, or hell, even some Eagles tickets, go to SeatGeek, utilize the promo code BROADS, you will get $20 off of your purchase. It's a no-brainer. Also, if you're new to the channel, make sure you smash that subscribe button, hit the thumbs up button as well. I greatly appreciate the support over on Twitter, at Broads81. That's my personal Twitter account. Smash the follow button there. And then lastly, check out BroadsMedia.com. We've been implementing more blogs and writing content. I really have been enjoying that. So, yeah, that's all I have to tell you before we roll on to it. So, now, we'll do that. Enjoy the show. What is going on, everyone? Welcome on into Sports Talk with Broads. It's been just an asinine day. News after news after news just continues to drop. Press conferences by Howie Roseman, Zach Ertz, what a professional he is. And then, of course, the head coach for the day after press conference. And I don't even know where to begin, but I'll tell you what, my frustration for Nick Sirianni's answers is probably at the top of my list, if I'm going to be honest. So that's where we will kick things off and kick things into gear. I just can not believe that we are sitting here listening to a professional head coach. Well, he's a coach of a team that plays in the National Football League. I don't believe he actually deserves to be a professional head coach. But when you're asked about the offensive identity, and then you start rambling on about how, well, we don't know. We have no idea what that is. There's a lot of teams in this league that are not 100% sure. No, and then you can see that he's backtracking. That is a sign of a man that is absolutely lost and confused and has no direction on which way to go. He seems like a nice guy. He seems like a harmless individual. But he can't coach football. He has no idea what he's doing out there. And that's why when we date back to the first press conference, you don't tell me that we're coming to a reaction too quickly. There were signs of this, okay? I love listening to everything happening in Los Angeles right now with the Chargers. Listen to that leader of men. Listen to that coach. He's young, but he's got control. This dude sold us garbage during training camp. And you know what blows my mind? Jeffrey Lurie and Howie Roseman, two people that I take a stand for and say, they've been successful over 20 years. There's something to that that I can't just pretend is not real. With that said, this man went into your office in Florida when they were going through all their interviews, and he wowed you to death. You were like, this is the guy. This is it right here. And then you go back to all the terms and the way it was phrased of he's going to grow into something one day. And then we hear Nick Sirianni speak about how they're taking steps. They like the process and where they're at right now. They're taking steps. Steps where? Steps where? Your quarterback can't make throws. Your quarterback's in the shotgun every play. You don't run the ball, which means you're putting so much stress on an already flawed quarterback to make every single damn play. That doesn't take Jalen Hurts off the hook, though, because these are NFL plays that have to be made consistently, and he just can't do that right now. So, you know, I'm very disappointed with a lot of the things I heard out of the head coach speaking. And I think it's hysterical. It's sad. I'm not, like, actually laughing. It's a sarcastic, painful laugh. But just the fact that Troy Aikman on the broadcast last night mentioned how during their production meetings, they already threw out there, so you thinking about switching who calls the plays already? If you're doing that already, you're a disaster. And then he gets asked about it today by the media, as he should. Is he not picking up on the signs? Enough with the Dr. J stuff. Enough with the Flyers hat. I don't want to hear it. Nick Sirianni is clueless, and right now in his career, he has no idea what he's doing. The game is moving way too quickly. The decisions are a mess. The play design, a mess. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers can get absolutely hosed in that secondary. 1,000%. And that's what you do. You talk about offensive identity. You probably should say, you know what our identity is? Getting the ball to our playmakers' hands and then trying to let them go to work. You're doing a bad job at it, but isn't that your identity? Isn't that what you're trying to be? Because that's what it seems. Screen pass here, screen pass there. Give it to someone fast and hope and pray something can happen. If that doesn't work, you're asking Jalen Hurts to scramble, and that's why you demanded that over the last couple of weeks, you were demanding from your team, let's do a better job at getting open once Jalen Hurts leaves the pocket and starts rolling around. That's your offensive identity. It sucks. It's not good. It's really horrendous, but that's what it is. It's a problem that you can't move the rock at all and gain a first down after that first series, which was extremely flawed. I don't want to hear it. Jalen Hurts threw a ball that got deflected. Quez Watkins just made a nice play. And Quez is a player. And that's my problem where everyone says, well, this team stinks. They do, but they don't. Devontae Smith, Quez Watkins, who had that catch at the back of the end zone, he was clearly interfered with. It was the pass interference call. He got pushed out of bounds. Quez Watkins is a baller. The kid can play. You're asking your wide receivers, without helping at all with scheme, you're just asking them to go out there and win every single matchup. I'm sorry, Nick, but this is your role. This is where you are supposed to be specific and have your fingerprints all over this offense. Help them out. You're not helping them out at all. You're leaving them out to dry. They're not the greatest in the world, okay? But there's enough talent on this roster offensively to be able to get a first down against a team in Tampa Bay with that secondary in shambles the way that it was. When Richard Sherman leaves the game, it's even more of an opportunity. And look, there's a difference between not having a run game and then passing the ball a lot. If you want to pass the ball a lot, fine. I'm okay with that. I'd be satisfied with an offense that likes to move the ball vertically. But if you make it non-existent, well, then you're just silly and it's screwing you up. It's baffling to me. It really is. No wonder why Miles Sanders is getting personal foul calls. He needs to be sharper. I would like for him to handle it better, but I get it. I'm annoyed. I can only imagine what he's feeling like. And look, the other day somebody mentioned me. It was actually Coffee with Broads this morning. Well, Broads, it's obvious that Miles Sanders just isn't trusted. And yeah, we've been through this a billion times. When you go out of bounds when you're up and you're trying to run the ball to keep the clock running, that's nonsense, right? That's high school Pop Warner crap that you learn when you're very young at this game, right, in this game. With that said, then what's the excuse? Because Kenneth Gainwell's not getting the rock. It's not as if they're saying, well, we don't trust Sanders, so we're just giving our 15 carries or 20 carries. We're just going to give that to Gainwell instead. No, they're just not doing it at all. It bothers me so much that here we are. Is it time to start trading everybody at 2-4 because Zach Ertz got traded? Look, Zach Ertz, the trade, it was inevitable. You kind of figured based off of what happened last year and the start to this season. If their record was differently, would they be moving in another direction? Probably, I'd say so. If they were 2-4 and they were 4-2, are we trading Zach Ertz for a secondary piece that has barely any snaps in his life here? And then a fifth-round pick? No. No matter what they tell you about Dallas Goedert, wanting to get him signed and him stepping into that role. And then, of course, they were really drilling Tyree Jackson. So it's clear Howie Roseman dropped his name a couple times. He made it very noticeable, too. Hey, Tyree Jackson. And same with Nick Sirianni. So, you know, that name, I think that they feel there's something to that. And if you remember, he had such a brutal injury during the camp when he was making a lot of noise and being explosive. Yeah, it's damaging. But you know, I mean, Zach Ertz and Dallas Goedert, the tandem, if you're actually winning football games, it's probably going in another direction. I'll say this, though. Actually listening to him speak to the media, that just screams, this dude is A+. This is an A+ individual. We knew that. It's not shocking, but to sit through it and to hear him and to hear his tone, see his body language, listening to his voice, the complexion in it, him talking about, you know, what he's doing for the community and making a church and a spot where people can get off the streets and go, this dude is obsessed with Philly. And then he goes on that rant about, not really a rant, but when he's asked about what it's like to be booed here and how we hold them accountable, and he loves that, and not every athlete is wired that way. Take note. doubts, Ben. I know it's not the right time because we're just processing the Zach Ertz news, but take notes, Ben. I thought Zach Ertz just showed his professionalism and how much of a good guy he really is. He just got traded and spent 17 minutes speaking to the media, then thanked him afterwards about everything and just openly just poured his heart out. And I thought it was a little strange that they knew he was going to be traded anyway, but let him play. And who knows, if he would have got injured, that would not that the compensation back in return is anything that is really the difference in this team making moves or not. I know the corner, Howie Roseman, mentioned that they talked to him a lot and they think that he possibly could be a player. They were looking at him in the later round, sixth round or so, but he ended up getting picked right before them. So, you know, obviously it's someone that they are aware of and they've spoken to before. But yeah, you know, it's just weird that they still let that happen. At the end of the day, it's a business. Go out there and have it, have fun, enjoy it. And he tweeted the picture before the game of him running out of the tunnel. That is now somewhat of a defining thing that we witness now that we know the news. Yeah, it's one of the best Eagles players we've ever seen. So many big moments, so many big catches. He's coming for Carmichael. He said maybe one day he comes back and snags that. If not, Harold can have the record, which I thought was pretty damn funny. But I guess here's one thing I will mention about that dialogue between the two. I thought the relationship was way worse than what it really was. I don't believe that Zach Ertz and Howie Roseman despise one another, hate one another. You remember all the storylines before about the toxic environment. And sure, look, don't get me wrong. There's ups and downs. And there's a lot of emotional times when you're dealing with this type of situation, but I really don't believe that it is as egregious. There's a reason why the Zach Ertz news dropped the way that it did. Howie coming out in front of it, answering the questions about it, having Zach Ertz speak. There's way too much respect and love, I think, between everything Zach Ertz has been through in this city. He might not be thrilled and then have this huge smile on his face about how it ended. And it seems like why we were asking, where's Dallas Goedert? Why is he not getting as many snaps? Well, because they're showcasing Zach Ertz for a team that might need him. And he had some separation. He was open throughout the game and whatnot. He had the touchdown, but it hurts when Jalen Hurts is trying to throw the football on third and five on an out route towards the right sidelines and he just misses completely and isn't even close. You know, that is an issue and it's a problem. It's problematic. I guess I just, maybe it's, and look, people are going to be like, oh, they're just putting on a show, bro. You're getting sucked in. No, I mean, you can see the high level of character that's in Zach Ertz, and I think at the end of it, he left nothing behind him. He approached this tenure and this season and everything with, I can't look back and say I didn't leave it all out there. So he's content with the way everything played out. Maybe not ideal. Maybe not the way he would have drew it up. Obviously, he'd be an Eagle for life for kind of guy. I guess it's just not as brutal as maybe we once thought that it was. But yeah, you know, Goddard playing more, it's something they want to see. They want to see him take that next step. And quite frankly, from a football standpoint, it's the best. It's probably for the best. Let's move on. I love Ertz. And I think he still has some left in the tank, but I'm not going to hold on forever. You start holding on to the Brandon Grahams, the Fletcher Coxes, the Zach Ertz. That gets you in trouble when you have these veterans at a certain age. You know, it's disappointing. But I do think football-wise, it probably makes the most sense. And I'm intrigued by Tyree Jackson, too. Not that he's anywhere super close. And it doesn't seem like Lane Johnson is either. You know, with all due respect to Lane and his privacy that he clearly wants, the fact that, and I get that we are accepting of it, and that's, look, I get it. It's very personal. At the same time, this is the NFL. The fact that your best right tackle, and arguably the best right tackle in all of football, is just gone. Gone. And everyone's looking around like, what's going on? This is a huge deal. This is a massively large deal that's happening right now with the right tackle of the football team. And nobody has an idea. I'm sure people are sitting on stories and people have it, but there's a respect level of not wanting to be the douchebag that puts anything out there. It's clearly something that's bad. I mean, it's bad at this point, obviously. But I just find it wild, as questions keep getting asked week in and week out, that it's so nonchalant. Yeah, he'll be back, you know, we don't have the timetable, but he's not back right now. Okay, this is only one of the most important pieces to the puzzle. You know, you talk about Eagles for lifers. This is Lane Johnson, who has an insane connection to who we are. to what we're about here, to the brand. And maybe that's why the respected privacy is there. I don't know. I'm thinking about if it's a one-year guy, one-year veteran who you signed and then he ended up saying, I need a personal leave, and he misses three or four or five football games, sure, I think we would be concerned and we would want to know what happened and we would hope that everything is okay with what's happening behind the scenes, but is the privacy level respected as much? Or I don't know. I don't know. I don't have the answer to that question. I don't have an answer to a lot of these questions. What do you think about this Eagles team? I don't know. I'm just destroyed. I'm destroyed in the head. I'm destroyed in the brain. I'm not destroyed, though, in my wallet. Why is that? Oh, I keep winning on DraftKings Sportsbook. Another week of the NFL season means another shot to win big at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NFL. New customers can bet just $1 in any NFL game and win $100 in free bets if either team scores a point. The last 0-0 tie in the NFL was in 1943. So I'd say this is a no-brainer. DraftKings customers can also get skin in the game with same-game parlays. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now and use promo code BROADS. Bet just $1 in any NFL game and win $100 in free bets if either team scores a point. That's promo code BROADS this week at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NFL. Must be 21 or older. Pennsylvania only. New customers only. Restrictions apply. In partnership with Meadows Racetrack and Casino. See DraftKings.com/sportsbook for details. Gambling problem, call 1-800-GAMBLER. I just can't get over the identity question. When I heard that, I absolutely lost my mind. And it's funny, Jeff Mosher of Inside the Birds asked the question on the Zoom call, and I texted him after. We're like, what? Did you hear that? He was fumbling all over the place. How in what world are we sitting here today and the head coach is honestly looking at the fan base in the eyes through a camera and saying, I have no idea what the identity is. And then he tried to backtrack. No one knows. Six games in, we're learning about ourselves every day. No. You're trying to maneuver through. You messed up. You caught yourself that you messed up and you tried to step backwards or tippy-toe around it. We heard you. We heard the fumbling. We heard the we have no idea what's going on in the head of mine type of answer from Nick Sirianni. He has no idea what the offense, and that makes sense. Nothing builds off of one another. There's no such thing as play action. It's just, hey, let's throw it there. Once again, let's get the playmakers the ball. But when you say that, he's not doing it the right way. Just because you throw the ball 1 yard to a playmaker, there's ways that it has to be done at a National Football League level. I think I heard it best this way. There's 32 head coaches out there, right? How many guys are waiting for that opportunity? There's no way that Nick Sirianni should be in that 32 right now. Because there's way more people that have the resume and that have the experience and that's ready to be the next head coach of an NFL football team. It ain't Nick Sirianni. He does not deserve to be in that spot. I know it's harsh. I get it. It's a little mean, if you will, but I mean, it's reality of the situation. And same with Jalen Hurts. The reality of the situation is you're looking at two individuals that are extremely overmatched. Can Jalen Hurts work in another situation? I don't know. I really don't know the question to that. Lamar Jackson has earned a lot of respect in the passing game. Can he just consistently work on Jalen Hurts for 2, 3, 4 years and just letting him grow? Possibly. I can't rule that out. I can't. But at the same time, you know, it seems like there is a cap on what he can provide. I would love for him to be the answer, though, because then those three draft picks in the first round, they look a little different. You can look in a different direction. I just don't know. And that's why we looked at this as the 17-game sample size, right? We weren't making a decision. We didn't head into the season saying, after week six, when they're 2-4, we'll have everything we need to know. We're taking steps into the direction of knowing. I think we have somewhat of a clearer vision on the issues and on the mistakes and on the entire organization right now, for sure. I mean, I think that's pretty damn obvious. But it's not all said and done. Here's what's going to happen. I know it. I just know it. You'll start seeing Washington. You'll start seeing the New York Giants. You have the Jets. You have the Lions. You have a Raiders team that doesn't really have a head coach right now because of the whole John Gruden mess. So where you're sitting at, you're going to be able to look better against these teams, and then the narrative might change a little bit. Well, doesn't it make sense? This is what we'll say after 17 games. Well, doesn't this make sense? You lost against the Tom Brady's, the Pat Mahomes, the Dak Prescott's. You beat the Sam Darnold's, the Matt Ryan's, and the Daniel Jones's of the world. And it's like, well, are you that bad? Are you that structured wrongly in terms of, you know, what you have in the head coach? Or if you changed your personnel and had stronger players, you would be able to match those other teams. The reasons why you're only beating the bad, bad teams and losing the good, good teams is because your personnel. I'm just saying, be aware when you start playing really garbage teams. Teams that have no good. Like, the Eagles are one of those teams, and believe it or not, there's actually teams that might be worse. Or, I guess, in the same category. See, they're in the same category, but I don't know why. Maybe I'm just doing this because I'm accustomed to being better than Washington or the Eagle or the Giants. Maybe they're in the same exact boat. Who knows? You split with both of them, you go 2-2 out of those four games, which means you're right on their level. Maybe that's the case. I don't know. But two of those games, if you do, puts you at 4 wins. You beat the Jets, 5 wins. I'm getting way ahead of myself. I understand. It's hard not to, though. I'm just saying, where we are now playing these teams, I know it. The tone will change. Things will look differently when you start playing weaker opponents. And then you got to find that balance of, well, is it more of the problem of your personnel? Is it more of a problem? I mean, look, you can't get first downs. You can't move the rock. You just can't. You can't even get first downs against a team that can get shredded. Oh, man, it's annoying. It's annoying. I'm just saying, I know how this works. Jalen Hurts supporters will start showing their head. People start to get more positive when things like that happen. And then you forget. It's like what happened against the Panthers. And I'm not saying I'm actually pissed just thinking about people changing their tone on this. Because after 3.5 quarters of slop against the Panthers, everyone's decided to say, who cares? They just won. What do you mean, who cares? They just won. Did you see the idea behind the week of game planning? That's pathetic. Anyone could have done a better job than that. So in what universe can we be satisfied with a half of a quarter? The same thing basically happened this week. It's unacceptable. 3.5 quarters of crap. All right, we're going to go to the Anytime Hotline calls. The Anytime Hotline is brought to you by Orbit Energy and Power. With over 20 years of industry experience, Orbit Energy and Power is home to your solar experts in both residential and commercial projects. At Orbit, they're dedicated to making sure your project is completed easily and properly by using high-quality materials and trained professionals. To get the job done right, Orbit also provides water purification systems, backup energy services, battery storage, electrical upgrades, new roofs, heating and cooling, and so much more. So make sure you check out their information at orbitenergy.us. Okay, let's go to the Anytime Hotline and hear what you had to say after this game.
Okay, this game was pretty much like a mirror image of the game last week against Carolina, in the fact that we played awful, like absolutely terribly, for the first 3.5 quarters of the game. Our opponent gets caught napped, and they just assume that they win, and we make a comeback. And the only difference this week is that we didn't win. And Avery, what a stupid penalty it was. I know it's a stupid, soft rule in these days, but you can't do that. And that just shows how undisciplined this team truly is.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt about it. Nick Sirianni does not have this team properly mentally engaged. When you see personal fouls, Miles Sanders being one of them. When you see Jannard Avery. I mean, we've been through the Derek Barnett process already. This is part of the issue with this team. They're not focused the way that they need to be. Now, penalties are going to happen, but you're talking about major penalties and major moments that help out Tom Brady. You know what you don't want to do? You don't want to help out Tom Brady. You get a 3rd-and-long scenario, and here's AB coming across, and Tom Brady, even though it wasn't even that perfect of a throw, was a little behind him. I believe it was Marcus Epps on him that could have made the play. You know, they ice it right there. Bang. Such a huge, huge first down that, you know, Tom Brady's going to make. And, you know, I haven't even really mentioned Jonathan Gannon at this point. You know where I stand. I cannot believe that he honestly assesses this team and goes, this is what I really feel is going to be the best against Tom Brady. It shouldn't be number one on your list. It shouldn't be number two on your list. It should be on your list, though, that both of these coaches at the top of the helm, one on the offensive side, one on the defensive side, they're lost. And it's not even just them. I don't like Shane Steichen. I thought that was a bad hire at the time. I would have went in 10,000 other directions before I hired his ass. But the fact that we're even wondering, what happens if we start changing the play caller? Come on, dude. We're already in that predicament. We're 6 games into the NFL, and now we're already talking about if Nick Sirianni can even call the plays or not. Oh, that's tough. Oh, that's bad. This is not Indianapolis anymore, my friend. You're going to be getting hit with them. And I love how he, like, and look, he's obviously going to say, no, I believe in what I'm doing and whatnot, which is whatever. He's lying to himself, but that's got to hit home, man. How do you know? Oh, we're going to self-reflect. Well, let's see. Let's see what the self-reflection is. I better see a huge night and day shift. Because I don't know how you assess what you're doing and then think it's fine to stay together with this brand. Self-assess, okay. Self-assess. Let me see what you see. Because I know what I see. I see garbage. I see a trash can. So it better be significantly different or else that tells me you just don't know what you're assessing. You have no idea what you're analyzing. Week one, that was cute. Now it's called film. Now it's called the NFL. Now it's called teams come up and they figure you out real quick. You thought Chip Kelly was a disaster. This has the pace to be one for the record books of how horrible it is. And that's why when he was at who? Nick Sirianni? Who is this character? It all makes sense now. I mean, honestly, it almost looks, which is the most bizarre part for me, it almost looks as if he's never been around the National Football League before. And that's what blows my mind about it. It goes back to the question, is Jalen Hurts that bad? That bad? Well, this is their only hand. He's that bad, and they're trying to hide it. I guess I'd have more respect if they took the training wheels off and said, fine, we'll show the people how miserable it is. Have at it, Jalen. And then we can at least find out. And then Nick Sirianni goes, look, I mean, I'm trying to run an NFL offense here. And obviously he's not going to say that and throw Jalen Hurts under the bus. But let's go. Stop with the RPO trash. Stop with this shotgun formation nonstop. Get under center and run a damn offense, Nick. It's a joke.
Nick Sirianni should be fired at the end of the season. I'm sorry, I don't care what the score was at the end of that Bucs game. The reason that score was close is because the Bucs stopped taking us seriously. The only time they took us seriously was at the end of that game. That was freaking humiliating. I went to that game and I saw 60,000 Eagles fans die inside. Wow. This guy is pathetic.
Yeah, he definitely isn't not pathetic right now. In terms of firing him or not firing him, I mean, I'm sure we will rant and continue this whole entire journey from now until that moment happens. Right now through 16th, I'm just not ready for that to start screaming because he's not getting fired today. He's not getting fired tomorrow. He's not getting fired after week 8. It's just not happening. So I will not waste my energy on that right now. But what I honestly do feel, I'll say this. I don't know. Like, if it continues this way, everything is on the table. I guess it is possible. But the most realistic scenario I see would be something like this. Chalk this year up to you didn't have the salary cap because of Carson Wentz, and then you have all these draft picks. I think that what they do is they give him one more year after this. I know this is big picture again. They give him one more year after this, and then they fire his ass after they don't see improvement after the second year, just so they can try and hide behind the fact that, well, you know, we're not just going to fire him after one season. We knew it would be a growing process. We knew that there would be a lot more to it, and he would have to adapt to the league and learn what it's like to be on those sidelines. Remember, he hasn't done this before. And then we go back to Jeffrey Lurie and say, exactly. So why the hell did you pick him when there's so many other people out there that were more deserving of the job? In what universe did this guy stand out the most when, quite frankly, he looks the most lost than I've ever seen out of a head coach on the sidelines? So that would be my guess for the long-term side of it, would be more of a, he gets 2 years and then they fire him after 2 years, say he didn't improve the way that we needed him to, and he didn't process, you know, the ways of head coaching the way we needed him to. But, you know, that's neither here nor there right now. That's off-season convo. That's week 17 convo.
Bros, Jake from New York here. I've got a few things to say about this fucking offense. First, I'm going to start with our quarterback that everybody loves. They only throws for 115 yards against the worst defense in the NFL in terms of pass. Now, to our running back situation, not only do I have Miles Sanders on fantasy football, but I'm also a diehard Eagles fan. Why the hell does that man get 7 to 9 carries if we're lucky?
I honestly do not have the answer for that question. It's malpractice is what it is. It's criminally underusing, and it is a fireable offense to have the run game this much lacking consistently game in and game out. We know the deficiencies of Jalen Hurts, as you just mentioned, and they are real. It's not being a hater. It's not hating the kid. I think every Eagles fan looks at the way he approaches the game and the way that he loves the game of football and the way that he is a leader. Who doesn't want him to be the guy, right? Who doesn't want him to be the answer? It would be foolish to say, you know, I'm really rooting for the kid to fail. No, everyone wants it to be him, but he's clearly struggling. Knowing that, and knowing that all you keep saying is I want to put these players in the best positions possible to succeed, how is having him being forced to make every play when they snap the football at a shotgun, how is that giving him the best opportunity to succeed? You have to take stress off of him. How do you do that? Hand the ball off. Make it easier on second down. When you fail and it's second and 11 or it's second and 10 because there's an incomplete pass or the screen pass gets blown up for a negative 1 yard type of play, you know what? It's different when it's second and 6 after you get a gain of 4. Second and 7 even. And then you get it to third and manageable. Third and 3. Third and 4. And from there, yeah, you got to make plays. You got to throw the football on time. You got to hit your tight ends or your receivers in motion as they're running their routes. Yeah, that's step two. But you're doing your players a disservice when it's drop back. Well, it's not dropping back. It's you're in shotgun. You're locking on to one receiver because I honestly feel he's getting coached to do that. What's the next move from there? I don't know if he even has the options off the play. That's how Bush League, I believe, Nick Sirianni is right now. After one read, all right, scramble. Let's see what can happen after the scramble. Really? Wow. Woof. Brutal.
Hey, Rose, just got out of my seat, went to my mirror, and made a strange-looking face. I did just enough as Jannard Avery did when he got that taunting play. That was abhorrent. Anyways, it's not the reason why we lost, though. The offensive play calling in the first three quarters was abysmal, and the defense did not know what they were doing in the first quarter. And we just need to shore up these kind of issues. Still, they didn't really accrue too much penalty, so they at least make progress in some regards.
See, I disagree. I can't go with the whole process in the right direction or what. If anything, I think that if you just look at the six games as a sample size, it's been pathetic. It's been miserable. There's been nothing that we were promised outside of what the coaches said that they were going to do game plan-wise. I'm just talking about having a young coaching staff that's innovative, that's new, that has this unique style to it where plays will build off of one another and there would be substance to their offense and you'd see a jet sweeps and motion and just new ways of football in 2021. It's been the complete opposite. It's been stale. It's been brutal. It's been vanilla, just a different style of vanilla. This time the vanilla-ness is all about just throwing it 1 yard to a wide receiver and hoping and praying something can happen. So, you know, that's where I'm sorry. I can't get behind the whole, you know, hey, there's progress involved with Nick Sirianni. Not really, no. If anything, they started nice in week one, and it's been a just downfall trend. There might have been a little up after, what was it? After the Dak Prescott in Kansas City, they won in Carolina. You might just because of the outcome. But see, I wasn't fooled by that. Some people put that up and went on the uprise because they won, and it was hard fought, and they came back from behind on the road, and that's awesome for some young kids. That's all great and dandy. They sucked for 56 minutes of that game. I'm sorry, sucking for 56 and then magically pulling it out. I said this from the jump. Don't be fooled by the win. You don't win those games 99.9% of the time. Look what just happened on Sunday. You don't win those games 99.9% of the time. Exactly. Exactly. You don't. Oh, but they rallied. Stop it. Stop it. That was an ass whooping. Honestly, it was. And with that, that's where we're going to shut things down today. Before we head out of here, do you want to get an advantage over your sportsbook? Download BetQL. Their best bet model scans over 350,000 unique bets per year to give you the best bet recommendation for every game across all major sports. Their model covers everything, spreads, over-unders, player props. There's sharp data so you can see who the professionals are backing. Line movements, you can jump on betting opportunities in real time. Team lineup breaking news and injury status updates. Head to the App Store or Google Play Store right now to download BetQL. Enter the discount code BROADS at payment checkout for 25% off any of their subscription offerings. All right, everyone, thank you so much for listening to this episode, and I will see you next time.